All right, we're going to get started because we have a really interesting panel and I want to make sure that they have enough time to speak. So this panel was designed around bringing in NYU alumni who work in predictive analytics and in relation to human rights in some way. But interestingly, it emerged that they're all people who work on policing or surveillance or both and have a lot of incredibly interesting insights into the questions that we've already started talking about. So it's going to be, in fact, kind of a thematic panel as well. So first we have Alex Chohlas-Wood, who's Director of Analytics at the New York Police Department, and he's actually going to give us an example or a couple of examples of how algorithmic analysis can be used as an accountability tool.
Thanks. Okay, hi, I'm Alex Chohlas-Wood. I'm the Director of Analytics at NYPD. I should note, I think since several people have asked, I'm not a graduate of the law school. I'm a graduate of NYU's Center for Urban Science and Progress, which is a new school that was created about 3 years ago that focuses on urban informatics. So I'm gonna be talking about a project today that we've been working on. This is the first time I'm speaking about it publicly, so I'm pretty excited to show that here. I would say, generally, I think a line through all the discussions we've been having today is that all of these processes, both the kind of low-tech decision-making that we've been doing for a long time and the new kind of tools that we're using, all depend on the data that we have. And, you know, I think maybe one of the most famous examples of data use in the police department here is this process called CompStat. And I won't go into this process, but I just wanted to note that, you know, I think we've been relying on data for a really long time in policing, and I think that's important to kind of think about some issues that might have actually been kind of going on for a while, and we're just maybe becoming aware of them now, and kind of what's new with these new tools. So one thing that is really important when you're in a CompStat meeting is, or at least is a kind of starting point for discussion, are these seven major crimes or seven major felonies at the very top of the page here, which include homicide, rape, assault, grand larceny, burglary, and grand larceny auto, among others. Okay, so as well as this kind of internal accountability tool, or in terms of felonies really inform this internal accountability process, these same seven crimes also really determine how we're measured by the public in terms of what's happening to crime in New York City. And these are just two sample headlines that I grabbed from recent newspapers, but essentially saying that these stats that we publish rely on these seven major felonies and actually just the total sum. It's actually another index similar to what we've been talking about. So we really rely on these data to illustrate not only internally but also for the public what's going on with crime. One really important part of us intaking crimes that have been reported to us is this process of classification. So not for all of these seven major felonies, but for a few of them, there are both felony components and also misdemeanor components. And this is a choice that's made by an officer and then approved at various points in the process, but it is a choice that we make dependent on the penal code. And essentially what you're trying to do is match what happened in the incident to what the penal code says about what's a felony or what's a misdemeanor. And I would say, so kind of touching on the first two slides here, the decision to make something a felony assault not only affects what we report to the public in terms of crime, it also affects how we keep precincts accountable internally, but it also affects in the moment if we classify something as a felony assault, for example, there's much more likely that we're going to make an arrest if there's a suspect. And also, of course, what we've been talking about for the whole day, which is that our data that we record really affect what happens down the line with modeling and forecasting. Okay, so in particular, I think just to kind of illustrate that this is a very important part of the process and that it has a lot of ramifications, there was a bit of a public spat recently last December about us, or excuse me, in January, about us potentially falsely classifying things as shootings. which, you know, from what I've seen, it wasn't the case, but this was a kind of public argument that happened between the current commissioner and the past commissioner. But there was also a story by the LA Times back in October about the LAPD systematically underreporting assaults over the past 8 years. And that's kind of what I'm going to be starting from today. So as part of this story, there's this paragraph in the story which said that the Times used an algorithm to basically read over the free text portion of every complaint that it had access to, and learned from those complaints whether it should be classified as a felony or misdemeanor. And they actually posted their code online, which was a kind of good starting point for us. Just to kind of use a chart from the article, it's important to note that the misclassifications that this algorithm captures, because it's reliant on the free text portion of the complaint, really are more about mistaken misclassifications, so situations in which all of the evidence is in this free text portion that the officer has recorded, but for some reason or another, they might be in a point of the penal code that's very confusing. They might have misclassified it that way. But the point is that this wasn't a practice that came into being and was kind of driven by political motivations. And I think that's what this chart shows, which is basically that there was this kind of like ongoing issue with misclassification of assaults. So this orange line is the LA Times proposed number, and the black line is what was officially reported. And you can see that there's basically, the trend is the same, but the volume is different, and that just kind of illustrates that this was a constant problem, more than, you know, maybe a more nefarious motivation. So a colleague of mine, Captain John Hall, I think had a really good insight here, which was that, you know, this code was available to us, and I think there was almost a responsibility to find a way to use it somehow. I think, you know, kind of comparing to what happens currently, our auditing team internally can only look at a small portion of complaints, and that's just a matter of how much time and staff they have. So there's no really current way for us to read every single crime and make sure that it's classified correctly. But also, in the same vein, no agency that we know of has used these tools to improve the auditing process. So we thought this was a really good opportunity, not only for us to take what LA Times had done, but also expand on it and really make it useful for our operations. So just to illustrate this process, currently our auditing team is only able to review about 10% of the assaults that we get every year, the misdemeanor assaults, I should say. And this is part of a much larger process of auditing. I'm just showing you a very small portion here. But the point is that we can only review so many because of kind of limitations on staff and time. So our model, which we adapted from the LA Times model, reads about 62,000 assault narratives, both felony and misdemeanors, and essentially learns to predict the difference between what's a felony and misdemeanor based on that free text portion of the complaint. In the process, it's reading about 3.7 million word and word combos. And then we can give it a new assault, and it will basically predict whether it's a felony or misdemeanor and give us some confidence as to how likely it is that it's one or the other. So then we can just take the ones that are most likely to be misclassified. In other words, there's a high likelihood, for example, that they're a felony, but they're currently classified as misdemeanor. And we can send that group of high-risk complaints to our auditing team for further review. So, you know, I think the great thing about this is we can basically review every assault in this way as a first kind of filter. And then what we actually do is just pass it on to our audit team, and they still make the final determination as to what that complaint is classified as. So just a little bit of results. This is based on historical data that the model did not see as part of the training process, but that our auditing team had looked at before. So it was essentially a vetted scoring set. And we found about 80% of the eventual upgrades based on this kind of threshold that we had chosen for sensitivity. Another way of putting that, so currently for every 100 assaults that our auditing team looks at, they only detected about 3.6 mistakes, and that's basically our baseline error rate. But with the model's help, they could look at only 10 and find basically the same volume of mistakes. So we're making them 10 times more efficient. And we expect that because now we can basically use this as a filter to catch most of the mistakes that happen across our assaults, that our baseline error rate would drop from around 4% to 1%. And just to illustrate this again with the same diagram, we're going to be preserving the same auditing process that exists already to catch complaints that don't fit into this modeling paradigm, but we're also going to be passing them these complaints that show a high risk of misclassification. So right now we're actually in the process of doing a evaluation in that's live essentially. So we're sending our auditing team a list of these complaints every week, just to make sure that we actually gauge effectiveness of this in practice. We're looking at improving it with other data, not only the free text data that exists in the complaint, but a lot of the data that comes with any complaint is categorical. And then we would like to expand this to other crime types, like grand larceny, for example, which historically has been a huge source of problems with misclassification. And then we're also kind of at the very beginning stages here of brainstorming about other types of misclassification detection. Like I mentioned at the beginning, this is really reliant on the information being in that free text portion of the crime report, but certainly there might be other ways that we could detect a little bit other types of behavior with regards to misclassification. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Okay, so now we're gonna hear from Elizabeth Joe, who's professor of law at UC Davis School of Law. And she's gonna talk a little bit about potential advantages and disadvantages of big data as deployed by police departments, as well as a few concrete suggestions for transparency and accountability measures.
Okay, so thanks. I'm gonna talk a little bit about an article I've written and draw some insights about concerns and also the potential benefits of big data policing. And then as for the practical part, if I run out of time, I'm happy to talk about them in the Q&A. So one thing I wanna talk about with big data is that earlier today there was talk about how policing is changing these sort of traditional types of policing, such as Terry stops and frisks, and those sort of traditional Fourth Amendment activities that we associate with policing. But I think big data also is having an effect on a very early stage of investigation that typically escapes the attention of lawyers because it really isn't thought of as a Fourth Amendment event. And it's something I call surveillance discretion. So surveillance discretion is really the decisional freedom that the police have to decide to just train their attention on one person versus another, or one set of activities versus another, without interfering with people in some of the ways we think of in a traditional Fourth Amendment way, such as a stop and a frisk. So what I think is interesting with big data is that in a traditional model, there are sort of natural limitations on what the police can do. There are only so many law enforcement officials, there's only so many hours in the day, et cetera. But with a lot of the big data programs that we're seeing now, in other words, filtering the physical world of just crime data we have, filtering the virtual world of things like programs that can attempt to predict suspicious activity out of, you know, tweets or likes or pins or online posting. This is changing the nature of this kind of very early stage of a police investigation. And so it dramatically lowers its costs and it dramatically expands police capabilities. So you've heard a little bit about predictive policing earlier today, insofar as the police might be directed to certain geographic locations to direct their resources. But this is happening also online. Some law enforcement agencies are relying on things like social network analysis to find out which people might be of interest, simply based on things like their social connections, as well as more traditional types of data, like criminal records and things like that. So I think this is a moment in policing where a lot of questions arise, both troubling and of potential good. So I wanna just lay out a couple of them very quickly. So as far as the potential advantages this kind of big data policing has, let me just quickly call them the bad discretion problem, the black box problem, and the paper trail problem. So when I talk about the bad discretion problem, I mean that this type of big data policing has the potential, at least in theory, of diminishing the very troubling uses of police discretion that we normally worry about, such as whether it's racial bias or the reliance on, let's say, informants to select investigative targets, these are all areas in which we worry about sort of basic human bias or even active discrimination. And we want, and big data has at least the potential to reduce some of those kinds of problems. When I talk about the black box problem, that what I refer to is we don't always know, and usually we don't, why individual police officers make the decisions they do. And Fourth Amendment law virtually ensures that, you know, the law doesn't even really care about the subjective decisions that individual officers make, so long as they have some sort of objective reason. So big data has the potential to diminish or minimize that sort of black box problem. And here I'm talking about the black box of the subjective human mind. If we could figure out what sort of data is used to help target investigative focus. And then the big data has the potential, at least theoretical advantage, of a kind of paper trail problem. Again, when individual human beings make a whole host of decisions, we can't know what they do, and in the aggregate, we can't know what they do necessarily either, or why they make certain kinds of decisions. So big data policing at least has the potential to produce a lot of data that is amenable, again, in theory, if law enforcement agencies open themselves up to audit or some sort of third-party review. So I think to the extent that big data holds a potential benefit, these are some of the things that we might think about. I want to talk a little bit about the concerns we might have with big data. Some of them have already been raised earlier today, so I'm going to very briefly mention those. Those had to do with mission creep, this idea that we don't always know how the algorithm comes to a particular decision, and also this garbage in, garbage out problem. I think these have been very commonly discussed. So I wanted to raise a few very big picture questions. I think that in a lot of ways, every new technology has the potential to make a big leap in thinking about what policing is. And I think that's what big data is doing. Every big technological change makes us think about, or should make us think about, what is the point of policing? It's not obvious that policing is necessarily just about crunching numbers to stop crime. That might be one of its goals, but it's not its primary goal necessarily, or maybe not its single goal. To go back in time, the patrol car was an enormous leap in technology. It had a great benefit in making police officers much more mobile, but it also had the disadvantage of creating a distance between police officers and their communities. So every time we have these kinds of jumps in technology, we need to think about, does it change the aim of policing? And does it minimize or even eliminate some of the values that aren't necessarily tied to data that we might want to associate with policing? Whether that's empathy, sort of positive discretion in the sense of giving people breaks. There's a social aspect or a community building aspect to policing. That's not really captured in a big data program. A second concern is that there is with big data programs, because they are sold by private vendors, a kind of hidden corporate influence on policing that's happening here. These are, for the most part, whether it's Social Media Monitor or PredPol, there's a whole host of companies out there. These start as startups, whether it's in Silicon Valley or in the Northeast. They start in the private marketplace as for-profit products, and we should be at least aware of that when we know that law enforcement agencies adopt these kinds of products. These are not necessarily things that are made in the public interest. They're made to be sold. So in thinking about that, it's really important to understand as a subsidiary matter that form is substance. That the way these products are shaped and designed actually produces the way we think about policing, how we measure policing success, so on and so forth. You can see that in all different kinds of technologies, not just big data. Again, to use a parallel, you might think about police body cameras, which are a huge, big trend in policing. There, one very under-discussed aspect is how the forms of these technological things, these objects, actually have an influence on the substance of whatever the police use with them, whether it's for reform, for evidence collection, so on and so forth. And then finally, there's this kind of decision-making problem, and that is big data doesn't just help police arrive at decisions, it actually nudges them. So everyone in this room has been nudged by big data, whether it was the last movie you watched, the last book you bought, even the last restaurant you ate at. But there, you know, whether it was a bad decision or a good one, the stakes were pretty low. But in the case of policing, when the police are nudged in certain ways, they're not nudged in others. And essentially, I guess the question here is, do we want policing to go towards a direction in which human beings are essentially are getting a veto vote? I mean, again, to use a parallel, when you get a suggestion from Netflix, most of us have a kind of cognitive miserliness. We just decide, well, I don't want to watch that suggestion. But you don't actively look for something else. So I think that kind of concept in policing has huge stakes in terms of how we think about what policing should do. So I'll leave that for now.
Thank you very much. Next, we have Ahmed Ghappour, who is assistant professor and director of the Liberty, Security, and Technology Clinic at UC Hastings School of Law. And he's going to talk about predictive analytics in the context of cyber surveillance.
So, hi, everyone. Thanks, Meg. I'm going to actually talk about a paper I'm working on provisionally titled Machine-Generated Culpability. And the paper focuses in part on applications in cybersecurity, but I will try to keep this as low-tech as humanly possible. So basically, the problem that the paper addresses is the intersection between two emerging trends in criminal law enforcement. The first being the trend of using big data and predictive analytics to prevent crime. The second being automated enforcement, and essentially two types of automated enforcement. The first, where humans are replaced by machines altogether, as might be the case with automated traffic cameras or the execution of an anticipatory hacking warrant. And the second being cases where humans defer to the judgment of algorithms or machines in adjudicative decision making, and so much so that the algorithm can be said to substitute human rationale or human thought. So in this context, machine-generated culpability is an inference that is generated by a rational agent or an algorithm allocating some threshold of guilt to an individual or a group of individuals. So you can think of this actually in the physical world. You can think of a dog sniff. A dog walks around and its sensors perceive the aroma, and it may alert if there is contraband present. Different types of contraband, depending on the different types of training the dog might have. The trend currently is turning to behavioral analytics that draw from one's past essentially to predict their future and their future culpability using artificial intelligence. Because of the complexity and the sheer volume of the data that's involved, computers have to be used obviously to filter, parse, process the data in order to identify digital signatures or patterns that identify the threat actors. And this is because the required analysis is beyond the limits of individual human cognition. That is to say that none of us could actually monitor the data that we're generating currently at this moment without having more time than we have in real life. But that's not all. So the more sophisticated the bad guys get, the harder it is to profile them. And the going trend in that area is that we need algorithms that self-improve and generate their own means of identifying perpetrators and threat actors, increasingly based on the machine or the algorithm's own rationale. And that's where methods like machine learning come in. So if we take a step back and we think about this, we have a configuration where you have a whole bunch of information that is processed by some algorithm or machine and an output that indicates some level of culpability, whether that be identifying the perpetrator of a known crime, predicting the imminent commission predicting a crime that's about to be imminent, that's about to be committed, and so on. So the problem, of course, occurs when a computer's rationale or when the algorithm's rationale or when the pattern essentially that the algorithm has created to identify threat actors is not articulable to humans. And that's sort of the focus of my paper, when the rationale is outside of the cognitive capacity of human beings. And so law enforcement decisions that are based on rationale or reasoning that's unarticulable are arguably arbitrary and lack a rational basis. So for example, according to a former engineer at Google, just because somebody has access to source code of an algorithm does not mean that he or she can explain how the program works. And that is the distinction between something like transparency or a conventional concept of transparency, where you can actually see the source code of a program, and something like the whyness of why a particular algorithm comes up with a result, which conceptions of due process and rule of law actually require. So if you ask that engineer, why did this particular program classify person X as a potential terrorist, the answer could be as simple as, well, X had used sarin gas, the term sarin gas, in an email. Or it could be as complicated and non-explanatory as, well, the sum total of signals titled X, or tilted X out of the non-terrorist bucket into the terrorist bucket, but no one signal was decisive, and so on. And the fact is, the latter case is becoming more common as machine learning and the training of data create classification algorithms that do not necessarily behave in wholly predictable manners. So police actions taken on the basis of these outputs or these inferences are at obvious tension with the rule of law prohibitions on arbitrary enforcement. And what my paper attempts to do, I'm not going to get too much into it at the moment, is come up with a constitutional decision rule, which in legal theory might be something like a decision-making criteria for judges in the implementation of constitutional norms, in this case, due process, to help courts and administrative agencies decide when and how much deference to grant machine-generated culpability. And the short answer is, of course, it depends. Long answer, happy to address questions in the Q&A.
Thank you very much. So our final panelist is Bahar Azmy, who is legal director at the Center for Constitutional Rights, and that's his leave time job. He's actually also a law professor at Seton Hall School of Law.
Thanks, Meg. So I feel like a bit of an outlier on this panel in terms of my kind of personal professional engagement with big data or predictive analytics as such. So what I thought I might try to do is put this sort of emerging trend in a broader political and historical context arising from some recent work I've been doing around challenging law enforcement practices. And I think based on these examples, one might think that I would find predictive analytics attractive, but nevertheless, I think there are some things that about it that still feeds my skepticism, despite my admittedly limited understanding. So to start with this basic premise, which is that naturally law enforcement has always tried to make predictive judgments about where criminality and danger might lurk. And especially in the post-Comstat data-driven area, municipalities all over the country have tried to be intentionally proactive in anticipating where crime might happen or is happening and making a predictive judgment that it might continue to happen there rather than in the sort of pre-Bratton model of simply responding to criminal acts on a one-off basis. And I think particularly after 9/11, there's been a heightened focus on a kind of preventative paradigm of policing domestically and abroad. And as a result of that, at least in the past 15 years, I've seen correspondingly in a number of contexts a resort not to kind of data-driven predictive judgments about criminality or suspected threat, but a different and deeply flawed predictive assumption that is simply profiling. That is, in the context I'm going to talk about, law enforcement, to some extent the courts, have accepted a set of crude stereotypes, not based on individual criteria, but on assumptions that around group characteristics that the law enforcement agencies have believed are probative enough to predict individual action. So I'll offer a few of these examples and see if, you know, think big data might be a curative. The first, and these are all just areas I've happened to work on. First is in Guantanamo, where the government has argued and the DC Circuit has largely accepted a paradigm of guilt by association. Looks to me a bit like the data association might get from a poorly constructed algorithm. So that, for example, an Arab man who was apprehended simply on the same route out of Afghanistan to Pakistan could be deemed sufficiently detainable, a part of Al-Qaeda or associated forces, or an Arab man who simply stayed at a guest house where Al-Qaeda members have at some point stayed could be deemed part of Al-Qaeda or associated forces, irrespective of individualized knowledge or intent. They might not have even known that this was that kind of a guest house. So rather than rely in this context on traditional law enforcement, criminal justice criteria, individualized suspicion, individualized guilt, and knowledge, intent, high modes of proofs, courts have accepted what looks to me like a series of pings of associational data points and drawn a circle around them to conclude that the individual is really no different than the group, and query if big data might change that normative judgment that these people are dangerous. Second, something we've talked a lot about, of course, is the NYPD's post 9/11 stop and frisk policy. And in the litigation CCR was involved with, after a 9-week trial, the evidence, in my view, overwhelmingly, and the judges, demonstrated the NYPD used a basic profile for assuming criminal suspicion. And that profile was, quote, male black 14 to 21. It was a determinative criteria for who would get stopped, frisked, and harassed by the police. Interestingly, of course, the NYPD relied on big data as a defense to the claim that there was profiling here. That is, the data revealed that 88% of stops and frisks in New York were of black and Latino citizens. The NYPD said, well, that doesn't prove intentional discrimination, because if you look at a subset of crime suspect data that we have, that shows that blacks and Latinos represent 88% of that constituency. So there's a match. And the court saw through that, both with the help of better analytical work by our expert, but also simply because it sort of saw through that what the NYPD was arguing, despite this sort of a compilation of data, is that just because blacks as a general matter are frequently more crime suspects cannot justify stopping and frisking millions of blacks and Latinos who have done nothing wrong. She said it's not a defense to racial profiling, it's proof of it. That's an example of the garbage in, garbage out phenomenon we've talked about. And ultimately, in the same, this sort of looked like the same computer pings sort of being, in that era, a young black man inside or near a Bronx housing project doesn't look that different than being an Arab man in Afghanistan in 2001. The third I'd mention is the NYPD's program of suspicionless surveillance of Muslims in New York and New Jersey. I think this is the same garbage in, garbage out program. You might ask, why would any law enforforment agency use so many resources on utterly suspicionless surveillance? Well, the program was based ultimately, in my view anyway, on a kind of junky and ultimately discredited report called Radicalization in the West, and that offered this kind of pseudo-scientific theory that could predict certain signals or indicia of radicalization that operated on a conveyor belt, where the first indicia was called pre-radicalization, involved a young Muslim male. So if you see a conveyor belt in which any young Muslim man is a potential threat to become radicalized, that might suggest you should be surveilling every Muslim man. One could also maybe include in this group, but we don't have time, drone strikes, particularly signature strikes, which are based on crude criteria. So given the kind of crude and archaic assumptions underlying these discriminatory law enforcement practices I just set out, might think that I might welcome predictive analytics, and that maybe I would trust Google more than I might ordinarily trust Commissioner Ray Kelly. And maybe, I admit I don't know all that much about the promise of this area. But I'm not so sure, and it's not only because I sort of feel duty-bound as a civil rights lawyer to be skeptical about the latest law enforcement tool. It's primarily because, as some people have already said, there is always in law enforcement and kind of ex ante and highly discretionary judgment about what questions to ask, what crimes to predict, and what communities to police. Recall again that the NYPD did rely on big data in its defense of the stop and frisk program. And that data, they insisted, proved them right despite overwhelming community demands to change this kind of over-policing, which was experienced, clearly is over-policing. And if we think currently about broken windows policing, I'm sure the NYPD can track very accurately where minor crimes are happening. But choosing ex ante to focus on certain sets of low-level crimes in specific communities of color is not necessarily in service of accurate policing, but of deterrent and preventative policing. And add to that, I think, a particularly dangerous kind of political phenomenon in the post-Comstat area that we all know from watching The Wire, is that, you know, mayors are consistently feel politically accountable to drop crime rates by, you know, infinitesimal margins year after year after year. So that adds to the pressure to use these kind of discretionary judgments. Police in primarily, I think, communities of color, they're often and pull together more analytic tools to serve that, you know, compelling political goal and increase that pressure. And I'm, you know, I also think about, as Jennifer Lynch earlier used the term feedback loop, but I'm reminded of a different metaphor of the self-fulfilling prophecy, and I'm thinking of Justice Ginsburg's amazing opinion in the VMI gender discrimination case, where she accepted certain empirical realities that on average men are stronger than women, and on average, she accepted that men are faster than women. And you could imagine, you know, a million kind of regression analysis to prove in different ways that, you know, that social, that asserted social reality. But of course, included that can't, that sort of generality, generalization, couldn't justify the exclusion of all women, in part because it would create a self-fulfilling prophecy. By not permitting any women into the school, you would never have the prospect that women would show themselves able to meet this neutral criteria and break the very stereotype that we should, in a democratic society, be committed to breaking. And so, I mean, we can ask, you know, here too, there's a risk that we, you know, to make a choice to focus on certain neighborhoods as high crime area, you know, with the patina of data and analytics and all that signals socially and politically, you might state a presumption about race, and it might risk reinforcing a negative stereotype that we should all be invested in eliminating. So I'll stop there.
Thank you so much. So I'd like to turn it over to the panelists and see if they have any comments to each other or even questions or want to kind of push the analysis further.
I guess one question or comment is, how can some of these concerns be translated around the country? I think because we're obviously in New York and the NYPD gets, you know, for good reason, lots of attention, but by no means is it representative of American policing at all. And I wondered if my other panelists had thoughts about, are there special concerns outside of the largest police force in the United States? Most police forces are quite small, their resources are quite limited. Should we be thinking differently in a system where basically we have a highly decentralized policing order, which is only somewhat guided by things like federal grants and just sort of new trends or new waves that sweep law enforcement?
Sure. I would just say, I think it's you know, hard for me to tell and kind of make a universal statement, but I think we are, as the New York Police Department, we're in a pretty unique position, I think, to do this stuff internally. And I think that my view on that is that if you can get the right people, and this is actually why I had that little note at the end that we're hiring, just because I think that, and not that this is the right crowd to recruit in necessarily, but that, you know, if we are internal, I think they're actually, maybe depending on who you ask, but there are ways that we can actually be kind of conscious of this stuff and not as a private company. We're really like liable to these things. So, you know, of course, that's only speaking for the police department. I think that certainly for a lot of these smaller police departments, I know that, you know, most of the police departments in the country are much, much, much smaller than we are. So I think that doesn't really apply universally.
Well, this ties in a little bit to your observation, Elizabeth, about the co-option problem, the corporate co-option problem, mm-hmm. Because you know, my concern often is the kind of at least in the kind of policing of Muslims or radicalization, the kind of political economy of this stuff, that is, that there are massive federal government resources designed, and you know, every day I learn about a new think tank that's thinking about radicalization almost exclusively in terms of Muslim communities, and that sort of creates, you know, dramatic incentive in small police departments as well to use those resources and to proceed on these programs that I think largely have a flawed premise. And so, you know, I sort of see the concern from a different area, access to the kind of latest paradigm of policing where there's heavy federal government resources, and then instantiating it not only in kind of, you know, experimental large police departments, but in tiny municipal police departments all over the country.
So I'm struck by how different your example is. I mean, your example is really about kind of using an algorithm to check what might be a mistake or an undercount of a certain kind of crime by the police itself. Whereas, you know, the other examples, I think, are sort of interfacing with human judgment maybe differently. Mm-hmm. So you have, your example is, you know, an algorithm to check a human activity, human judgment, and then it goes back into a human activity to check again. So. And then maybe what, Elizabeth, you're talking about are algorithms that perhaps suggest or even direct where human activity should be concentrated, so automated suspicion of some kind. Ahmed, yours is about, you know, algorithms that direct human behavior. I'm sorry, that displace human behavior. They actually automate culpability, as you said. And then, you know, we have the question that Bahar tees up. Is this, you know, is automation or algorithm actually useful when, in my experience, in fact, the NYPD used big data as a defense. Happily, the judge actually saw through that. But so are those differences of kind that we can learn something about, or sort of how do you all on this side relate to Alex's example, maybe is another way of asking that question. Is it a difference of kind, or is it just he's in a different position? It's not.
Well, I mean, I love the example. I mean, it seems that this is data to ensure internal accountability and sort of that internal processes are accurate and the department is accountable to its mission. And it strikes me that's the kind of slightly less politicized use of big data that would be interesting for any governmental entities to deploy in any context. The concerns that I have and that my co-panel share are when big data gets merged with, you know, a political interface with the community. and there are judgments about how to interact, police, control the community, where I worry, and this really is just my you know knee-jerk civil rights kind of concern about ensuring law enforcement accountability, just you know a ratchet that goes in one direction, that direction is you know potentially around policing communities and the more vulnerable communities.
Just to sort of tack on to that, I think the important probably the essential factor in checking the algorithms or the use of big data that you're talking about, or even the sort that Alex is talking about, is that you can actually articulate the rationale. So basically, while Alex was describing what basically it sounds like you guys are applying very heavy computation of a lot of numbers to produce statistical outcomes, which is not really an intelligent, like it's not when you think of, you know, like Google doing the autocomplete and artificial intelligence and that sort of thing. And you could explain the methodology behind your results, right? And then in that way, we can hold you accountable. And the same thing with the use of big data in the stop and frisk case. You guys won that case, right? And part of, I mean, you got to cross-examine the person that used some sort of methodology to produce the results that supported the police behavior. And obviously, the judge did not agree with those results, right? But that was because you could actually inspect the underlying rationale. But the fear that I have, not really fear. The trend is that we are heading towards an era where we trust whatever this thing says over here, and we don't really know how it works, and we don't really care anymore. So fast forward to a time when the algorithm is no longer transparent, and we just believe it, right? And that's really when we get into this. We turn ourselves into a Kafka novel, basically, right? Mm-hmm. That's the fear, I guess. And how can we stop that, or not stop that? How can we insert the right checks and balances when the legal community has no idea how technology works, and the technical community has no idea about the law? So, for instance, about a year ago, actually, I was talking to a deputy engineer for a very, 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 very powerful machine learning algorithm, and I asked him whether they had some system or they were even thinking about internal checks in a way that would describe why a certain result was what it purported to be. And the response was, that's not efficient. And being a former engineer myself, that would have been my response too, because as an engineer, the whole goal is to make things more efficient. Or perform better, but maybe what we need to do is change the definition of what perform is, or performance is, in applications that deal with socio-legal problems, right? How exactly to do that, other than having a conference like this every day and inviting all the engineers and lawyers in the world? I'm not entirely sure.
I guess one thing I would add is I think that you know the program that Alex describes is a different sort of program than the concerns we have, because I think we would all agree about the background assumptions of such a program. We all want every kind of governmental agency to have that kind of internal accountability. I think the difference with some of the things the rest of my co-panelists have talked about is that these big data programs are often working in the backdrop of discretionary decisions that not everyone knows anything about, and traditionally we haven't known anything about. So enforcement priorities are notoriously difficult to pin down, whether that's at the level of the individual officer or it's the department. You know, departments typically don't, law enforcement agencies don't typically ask communities, what would you like your enforcement priorities to be? And in the very rare cases in which that's put to some sort of democratic mechanism, such as a city ordinance, they usually fail. Mm-hmm. So I think that's the big contrast here.
Can I just underscore a point Ahmed made that also reminds me why your work is
still somewhat far more terrifying than mine, which is the sort of the, Ahmed's right, and this goes to a way in which I could see data being like the kind of analysis Alex is doing, an accountability tool. So quite possibly the only reason we were able to bring the stop and frisk case in the form that we did as a class action is that, actually based on an earlier settlement, the NYPD agreed to record demographic information and the reasons for the stop every time a stop was undertaken. So we had available to us 4.1 million pieces of data, infinitely more actually, 4.1 million forms with data available to it. So it was that kind of analysis that contributed to a finding of systemic discrimination that we were able to do, would not have been able to do if there weren't some kind of record keeping. And I know the, you know, activists are pushing the Chicago Police Department to keep that kind of data and make it public. Seems to me like my dream would be to have this as a sort of elementary best practice of every police department in the country. That kind of transparency can be transformed into accountability. But what you're talking about, wow.
So that's a kind of, I mean, basically what you're saying is there needs to be the same kind of big data available to the public so that they can run the analytics as well.
Right.
To some degree. So what are some other elements of either transparency, accountability? Elizabeth, I don't know if you want to jump in here with maybe some of the specific recommendations you make in your paper or elsewhere, and any others that you all might have about sort of how to tackle these problems.
Sure. I mean, just a very quick thing about, I think because of the comment I made before that much of American policing is really hyper-local and decentralized, I think there's a big role to play here with new technologies like big data for local communities to try and regain control, whether that's just simply requiring police departments to notify them when they're going to adopt new sorts of programs, whether there's going to be some sort of accountability with auditable data that law enforcement agencies are supposed to release. This is very much an area where we're making these piecemeal decisions all around the country, and the danger here is that these practices will become embedded, and some of their work, you know, the concerns that are raised in a conference like today are going to be sort of firmly entrenched before people really understand, local communities really understand, how has policing changed in my community, it's too late. They already become sort of a standardized police practice. So this is a way in which local law can really do quite a bit, I think.
Yeah, no obvious recommendation. I mean, I'm just observing, and Elizabeth mentioned this as well, a basic kind of political reality. I mean, given the either how you framed it, the sort of background assumptions that drive the questions that police departments want to ask, or as you know, I think we each put it, the kind of discretionary options that law enforcement has to choose, you know, what questions to ask and how to use the data. The ultimate check is, you know, the kind of political community action. These things happen that I described over 15 years because I think to some extent a lack of respect for the communities of color that are affected by these practices, and then, you know, license to undertake the discretionary judgments law enforcement wanted to take. And in two of the three of these instances, the communities have become politically mobilized and demanded some transformation, and that can only be, you know, that has to be sustained as a way to limit the range of discretionary judgments that the police can make. It changed in obvious ways with the, you know, politics in the city around stop and frisk, and we're seeing some progress in the kind of Muslim civil rights coalition building area as well, but hopefully limit police discretion. That report that I mentioned, as a result of litigation, challenging the cases in New York, challenging the NYPD's suspicionless surveillance in New York, though our case is challenging it in New Jersey. The NYPD agreed to take that report off its website, just for example.
I think just on the, at least the issues that I was speaking to, it's part of a bigger problem where the judicial bench, essentially, does not, they're out of touch with technology. And so one of the big issues is how do we build that competence as a structural sort of infrastructural kind of issue. I think there's a really good stat here in New York. There was a magistrate judge that solicited amicus briefs from the EFF, and I'm pretty sure, I need to check the stat, but it was some insane statistic, like every time an amicus was solicited, but maybe two times out of several, the warrant was not granted, because the judge actually got or understood what was going on, presumably, right? Which is huge, and that's sort of a big issue that's lacking in the courts.
One very specific question, then I'll open it up. How successful are kind of traditional transparency tools, like just take FOIA, for example? Are they very successful at obtaining algorithms, for example? I mean, you've talked about your mm-hmm. Discovery,
yeah.
Obtaining, really helpful data. Is that, what are the tools in this area? Any sense of that?
Yeah. I don't know what the tools are for algorithms. I mean, I think just to take FOIA, for example, I think FOIA is becoming an increasingly difficult way to understand law enforcement decision making, because there's a sort of broad law enforcement privilege that police departments and law enforcement departments invoke. That is, if you understand how we operate in certain ways, criminals, the bad guys will kind of reverse engineer our processes and be able to evade law enforcement. And I don't know how that would jive with certain kind of algorithms, if that would be relevant. I would think the stuff Alex is doing would be FOIA-able. And maybe even, the NYPD would affirmatively want to share that as they are here today, so.
I would also say, thanks. To kind of address some, I think, previous conversations on other panels and also just to this point too, I think my personal kind of instinct with algorithms is I definitely kind of lean towards wanting them to be transparent, but I think there is something that hasn't been mentioned, which is like some sense of gameability.
Yeah.
And so, I didn't talk in this example, for example, about certain words that might tip off the algorithm to say whether it's a felony or not. And I think that that's something, especially on this accountability stuff, that could be very sensitive. And especially when we're talking about things like maybe officer performance or something, then that can get like very hairy. So that's just one concern I've had and kind of thought about and wanted to just mention something I've been thinking about.
Just on that note, when litigating, one thing that I've confronted, and I'm not sure if we mentioned it on this panel yet, is sort of the use of private companies' software by police and generally law enforcement, which I think should be outlawed entirely, unless the company signs some sort of agreement that if the software itself is challenged, you can actually show the source code or whatever to at least in a sealed setting, right? And so when you bring up these issues of gameability, we have a court system that actually maintains an order where I, with a security clearance, can look at classified national secrets. The idea that I can't look at a trade secret in order to save someone's life is ridiculous. Yet, for whatever reason, it's something that we have almost no hope of changing. That in combination, so that's a whole other different type of black box, but that in combination with the algorithmic sort of the cognitive opacity of artificial intelligence moving forward is really creepy.
I think if I could
that's
jump
a legal term.
Yeah. I think that's right. I mean, I think one of the topics that needs to be explored much more is the way in which intellectual privacy rights are clashing with defendants' rights in this context. And I think we'll see much more of this as more of these programs will proliferate. I mean, ultimately, there's going to be a lot of competition about who will have like the most marketable program. And we're seeing this in a lot of areas, not just with big data to predict, you know, where to send police officers, but also in the context of DNA and, you know, what private software police agencies are using to determine whether in certain contexts, you know, we've made a match. And there are cases being litigated now where defendants are being denied access to source code and these things. And as Ahmed points out, it's not obvious that trade secrets really should outweigh defendants' rights at all. So.
Great. Okay, let's open up for questions on the floor. Yes.
Hi. Just want to thank the panel, a lot of interesting stuff. And I'll say up front, I'm not a computer scientist, and I'm not an attorney. And I was struck by the discussion of, phrase was machine culpability. And I guess a lot of this has to do with the opaqueness of the algorithms. So I'm thinking back to a phrase that was coined a good while ago about privacy by design. And I'm wondering if people are in the computer science community, in predictive analytics, are working on algorithmic accountability by design, where you can basically query an algorithm to explain why it came up with the result it did, and maybe in legal terms, or at least TV drama terms, cross-examine the algorithm. Is any work being done in this area?
Well, I just have an anecdotal answer to that. I'm full of anecdotal answers. So about a year ago, again, I was sitting in David Clark's office. David Clark is an MIT professor that basically invented the internet. He's really, really smart. And I was trying to articulate this issue that I'm now calling machine-generated culpability. And he was like, oh, you mean the whiness problem? So yeah, we've got some people working on that. So apparently there are some very, very smart people working on that at CCL at MIT. Aside from that, I'm not entirely sure from personal experience or research. And then there's more issue. There is some work in computer science on what might be called it is a process that turns an opaque algorithm into a rule. But that's not the same. That's explaining the results as opposed to explaining how the results were generated or why they were generated, at least coming from the legal perspective, from a jurisprudential perspective.
Sure. I was sort of thrilled when, even before I could ask the question, you were addressing some of these things. And you mentioned the person who said, well, yeah, if we had to explain, it would make the algorithm inefficient. And my only comment to that is I would think the customer gets to decide what the customer wants, and if the customer really wants it, the computer scientists will work hard to make it efficient.
Yeah, but the customer needs to understand what's going on, which is a whole other problem with government using technology, and that's sort of it's self-evident, I think.
I mean, just to follow up on your point about the sort of judicial capacity lack or the lack of judicial capacity here. Do you have any recommendations on that front? I'm struck by your kind of analogy to classified information, because, you know, a judge can go into a SCIF and look at documents and they're usually going to understand them. I mean, the CIA or NSA might say you don't understand it, you know, et cetera. But it's basic English on a page usually. This seems like a huge problem, like a problem of a different order. Do any of you have thoughts or recommendations? Is it usually special masters who are experts in this stuff? Like, what are some options here? Anyone?
Some options would require the bench to take proactive measures to bring in folks in the form of amicus briefs, for instance, or to hire clerks with a technical background. I know Justice, I believe, Ginsburg. This year, I saw that one of your tweets, basically, is hiring a clerk from Berkeley, who used to be a Google engineer, so that's awesome. Hopefully it wasn't just like a user experience engineer. No offense to user experience folks. But there are other initiatives. So over the summer, again, last summer, I spoke to someone who mentioned that the ACLU, Chris Seguin, who is a PhD in informatics, and Bruce Schneier, who is basically the guy that taught everyone crypto, were giving at the federal judicial conference, were giving basically lessons on or classes on law enforcement hacking, for instance, so that judges could actually know what it is that they're approving, which is a step, right? So it's things like that.
Well, I think it's a real problem, and I think one of the things that that exemplifies this is, I'm sure everyone's familiar with this Apple FBI case. There's going to be a hearing tomorrow in San Bernardino, but just being an interested observer of what's going on in that case, there's a really difficult problem of law, which both sides can disagree about, but there's also a technical issue, which is also being litigated. Technical issues shouldn't be sort of the products of persuasion, I would think. I mean, you're a former computer engineer, so that's the real problem. I mean, the law is just a really terrible place to persuade people about what the correct way to understand technology is, and yet here we are, so I don't know if
And here's where we've been, too, by the way. I mean, my dean at Hastings is a law and science guy, which means he's been writing on this issue for years. So it's not just a new thing with computers and algorithms. Everything could be thought of as an algorithm, I guess. But it's just the use of science in courtrooms at some point, and till today, has really been confronted with disdain or by the courts and by lawyers generally, just because we don't understand it as a profession.
Hi, quick comment and then a question for Alex. So the comment is actually, it's interesting to see in the machine learning, predictive modeling kind of field, the sudden problem, the awareness of the data problem. And so many of these algorithms are refined and perfected on data that is supposedly real world data, but that introduces all kinds of problems because they aren't necessarily, we don't really know what the data is, but we think we do, it's labeled data, but it's describing phenomena that we don't fully understand. And so there's been some interesting research done on using synthetic data, something where we can control all the variables and actually validate that a machine learning algorithm does what we think it is, what it's doing, which really is, you know, taking the past and describing the future, at least what we hope it does, which of course gets really tricky with humans. And before I ask my question to Alex, I have to disclose, so Alex and I are both graduates of NYU Center for Urban Science and Progress and are friends, but I'm actually really kind of interested for him to say, to talk about the kind of the process for selling this internally at NYPD. We, you know, as one of the panelists mentioned, right, we can all agree this is a good thing, internal accountability. I can imagine, though, there may be officers, even though this is a procedure in place to review these, that might become concerned that they're kind of having their work reviewed, in a sense, and what gets to what we've been talking about, I think, so far today, which is this interpretability and the accountability for this, especially if this is something that might be judged on. How many of your misdemeanors were turned into felonies? So if you can talk about kind of internally at NYPD, how this model, what you've been doing has been seen, kind of as a proxy for some of these other things about accountability with algorithms.
Sure, yeah. So I think one thing that has become clearer to me as I've joined the department is that the kind of like wire narrative, I think, of the like very strong downward pressure on crimes isn't really as present as far as I've seen it. And I think part of the reason for that is because we do also want to hold precincts accountable for what's going on in their precincts. So there's this actual, there's a strong motivation the other way in terms of we really want good data so we can know what's going on. Before a problem gets much worse than it is now. So I would say generally, and I think that is reflected in kind of the strength of our auditing arm, which as our understand it is like kind of one of the biggest auditing arms for any agency. And you know, not to say that that hasn't kind of been growing as these kind of in the past decade or so. So there's definitely strong internal support for this stuff. I would say also that, you know, frankly, I think maybe similar to kind of people who are coming from the law side of things, same with policing, there's not really a good handle on like really the full spectrum of things that analytics can do. So I think there was actually an element of surprise that we could use this for accountability purposes. And that's kind of one of the motivations for me being there in the first place. And so I think that was something that was really nice to see, I guess, was that people were just genuinely excited about this, and particularly in the sense that we would have a better sense of what's going on, and that we could help make this auditing team much better at what they do.
Yes. Hi, I'm Cynthia Conti-Cook from the Legal Aid Society. I have two questions for Alex. One was, I was wondering if you could speak to the observations made so far in the three precincts where the Hunch Lab has been piloted. And also, from the White House 21st Century Task Force, I think there was an initiative to promote more data sharing among police departments across the country. And with the CompStat 2.0, we saw some of that released from the NYPD. But other enforcement agencies have also extended that to law enforcement activities like car stops and stops. Are we going to see that evolution hit NYPD?
Thanks. To the first point, I think there's been a little bit of confusion about what's going on with predictive policing internally. And I can't speak too much about it, but I can say that we are testing a series of vendors, actually. So we're not only working with the vendor you mentioned, but with a group of vendors. To the second point, I think it's a the CompStat 2.0 dashboard was something really exciting for me because, you know, personally, I can get a like spreadsheet of data and download it and map it and be totally fine doing that. But I think most people in the city really don't have the capacity to do that. So that was, and for people who don't know, we released this map that basically is the same information that we use internally for accountability that people can interact with online to see crime in their neighborhood, and it's updated every week. So that was a positive thing, and I think it's a little bit different from the kind of standard open data narrative in the sense that we're actually providing a tool for people to use rather than just a data set. But we also, around the same time, released 10 years of the same incident level data that's available on the open data portal. And then, you know, I won't kind of speak as to the original motivations, but we do also release stop and frisk data, and we also release collision data. So I think actually, in terms of like police departments across the country, we're a little bit more liberal with our data. I won't say that like we're doing the perfect job, but I think we're moving to that place. Yeah.
Yes.
How is stop and frisk and what to do with stop and frisk in the department different from predictive policing since you're looking for vendors to bring this in? How would it be different?
I guess I don't do much work with stop and frisk data. I think that most of the data that we are providing to the vendors, actually all of it, doesn't have anything to do with stop and frisk, I mean, at least directly. It's much more about citizen-reported crime. So, you know, there might be indirect connections, but certainly that's kind of what predictive policing relies on, I guess, is the citizen-reported data. Yeah, I mean, I would say, I think ballpark around 93% of our crime records are reported by the public. So there's a small percentage there that are, you know, essentially picked up by officers, but by and large, it's citizen reported. Okay. And not to say there aren't issues with that, something I'm definitely concerned about as well, but, you know, I think we, as practitioners kind of have to deal with this tension between having to take action today and like wanting something perfect for the future. So, yeah.
Do you have a follow-up?
Yes.
Go ahead.
So the department did not consider stop and frisk predictive policing?
Maybe you could clarify. Yeah.
Well, in the terms that we've been talking about predictive policing today with the use of big data, and the expectation with stop and frisk that you would be policing areas where there was supposedly more crime. And so I'm just wondering how the department has parsed out the distinction between what happened with stop and frisk and predictive policing.
Sure. Yeah, I guess, you know, I've only been there for a year and a half, so I can't really speak to what was happening at that time. I think, as far as I understand, I think those indicators of high crime areas were actually not really reliable, at least as they occurred on the form. My hope at least is that our reliance actually in this data-driven way on the citizen-reported data is going to be different than kind of having these a little bit more subjective criteria for who we stop, I guess. That's my hope.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Patrick.
So there's a lot in this conversation about algorithmic transparency and the difficulty of figuring out what an algorithm's doing. I want to urge us to stop using the word algorithm, because the algorithm isn't actually, I think, the problem. The problem is the training data. And once you mix the algorithm and the training data, you get a model. The model can be tested. You can do all kinds of really cool stuff to figure out what the model's doing, if that's actually your interest, without actually knowing about the internal statistical parameters of the model. And that kind of black box testing involves creating a bunch of synthetic data that tells you the things you want, dropping it through the model, and seeing how it gets classified. And practitioners do this all the time. So one of the reasons that we don't worry about efficiency so much, and we don't worry about interpretability as much as maybe we could, is that we have other ways of addressing the problem, which are perhaps not obvious to people who don't do this all day, because they're a little bit counterintuitive. But there are ways to unpack transparency without source code and without the training data just by using the model parameters. And so I think there's ways we could maybe make this conversation richer that would get us toward some kind of handle on transparency without chasing things like source code or the raw data, which we're not going to get either of, I think.
How do you distinguish what you're talking about from accuracy assessment, and how then do you distinguish accuracy from whiness? Not transparency, like whiness, which is different than accuracy.
I don't know that we're going to ever get to whiness. I think whiness is a really hard figure. I don't have any answer at all for that.
Because the law loves whiness.
Yeah.
I got to put you in jail, I got to tell you why.
I don't know that we can get to why, but what we can do with a black box test that's different from accuracy is we can construct records that are about the kind of things we're worried about. We can construct a record that has the variable values that are the things that are concerning us and drop it through the model and see what the model does with it, and come up with classifications from the model. And by doing that a bunch of different times, we start getting a feeling of what the model's performance is, what it's doing, what kind of things interest it, and what kinds of things it ignores. And those are often counterintuitive, even when we know the variable importance scores and all the other stuff that we think is actually telling us about the model. I find those things to be much less informative than we think. So there are ways to get a handle on it, but they're often not, they don't look exactly like what people think they might look like.
I just have a quick comment. I think that's a really good point, but I just to build on what Ahmed said, that the law loves whiness, so without that answer, it's a really problematic. And then the second point is the law loves metaphors, and I feel like algorithms have already taken hold as a metaphor, and it stands in for so many things that I think it's not analogous to, like formula or, you know, objective truth. And so that's the kind of the clash that we're sort of addressing here today, which is the law and technology are actually sometimes talking completely past each other, and that's the essential problem. Except the law has the kind of finality in the way that the technology doesn't.
Helen?
I was thinking, I think it was your comment, Ahmed, about why we trust our phones, for example, even though we can't look inside them. And that was provocative, and I think it's because, at least for me, it's that every, let's say, the watch on my phone, I look at the watch, tells me the time, this is the right time, and it's so many, you know, so many occasions, I now trust my watch to tell me the time. So, and I think this gets to some of the conversation that we've been having, not the whyness part, but how would you know that the predictive algorithm that you're using is good enough in the same way as my phone I now trust because it's been telling me the right thing, like say the stop and frisk question. And let's go to the college admissions scenario for a moment. I'm Harvard and I get, you know, I don't know, 80,000 applications. I choose 1,000, I don't know how many they choose. And then 10 years later, I say, gee, whatever algorithm procedure we used, that was excellent. Look, CEOs, presidents, so forth. And of course, we're all sitting here and saying, yeah, what about the other 79,000 that you didn't? First of all, the fact that they went to Harvard, blah, blah, it's self-fulfilling. Now, if you look at predictive policing, here's the question, the normative question is, if you do the stop and frisk, you use an algorithmic method, which is better than the subjective method, to select out those people you're going to stop and frisk, and then you find that the number of people that you actually find are carrying, whatever the thing you're looking for, has increased somewhat. Do you pat yourself on the back and repeatedly say, yeah, that's good. I think we'll keep using it. We don't know how this thing works, but it's giving us good numbers. Or do you think that in the case of policing, we actually have, criminals have to have like an equal right of getting caught, if you know what I mean. And I'm asking anybody in the panel, is there something different about the accuracy that we're asking of the predictive policing that we don't necessarily expect from the Harvard admissions algorithm?
I was just saying I was starstruck because you said I made a provocative comment and therefore I can't really respond. Moment. You guys go ahead, please. Well, I will share an anecdote. In the meantime, I was just informed of this like a couple days ago by Nancy Hollander, who's an amazing criminal defense lawyer. So Nancy, I was talking to her about the dog sniff, and she said, because she's an expert in almost everything related to criminal defense, she mentioned that, for instance, when a dog is 100% accurate, or not 100%, but very accurate, but in the field, the dog stops by a trunk 3 days in a row, or three incidents in a row and alerts, even if there is contraband in the trunk, at that point you have to take the dog out of the field and do what's called proofing to make sure that the dog has not been retrained to, you know, stop the trunk as opposed to stop when there's contraband. And I just found that kind of interesting. It's sort of a distinction between accuracy in the field, which might be one of the factors, and again, I go back to whyness, but I think there are various criteria. It all depends how you define performance, and I guess one of the issues, I think the other gentleman mentioned something really technical, and then performance, and there are other ways that we can measure performance, and I'm totally with you, but it depends how you define performance. Any agent, if it's like a quote-unquote rational agent or an intelligent agent, the way that you would judge it or the way that it would work is to basically achieve a high performance result. And if we define performance as whyness, all of a sudden, you don't get those really complicated, I mean, you just can't have a really complicated algorithm. You have to have a series of if-thens. If this person's wearing a blue suit, then, you know, he's a criminal, for instance. I can explain that, which is huge in court. But all that Bayesian stuff, It does not comport at all.
I mean, I guess one way to think about it is to just build on something Vara said before, and that is it depends on context. And so in criminal procedure, law of criminal procedure, well before the age of big data, we had incredible amounts of deference to the police in their just subjective considerations of who's suspicious. So I guess it's sort of like, well, which evil are you going to pick, right? If you're going to have a situation where we permit police to stop people because they're in an area that's designated a high crime area based on what the police told us was a high crime area, and they ran away from the police for reasons we don't totally know or care about, and yet we can stop them, well, I query whether maybe an algorithm is better than that situation.
Just to comment on that, I think there's a difference between that problem and the not understanding the reasoning problem. Mm-hmm. And I've mentioned that before. So full disclosure, my father-in-law is a police chief, and one of our first conversations, I was talking to him about automated policing and how they were replacing him with this machine and stuff, and all these matrices and the booklet that you mentioned earlier, and how I was a big fan of the sniff test, not the dog sniff test, but the police sniff test. And I go around saying that a whole bunch at conferences or events like this so that some very liberal-minded people stand up and tell me how horrible I am. But the response is, in practice, to some extent, I can cross-examine a cop, and I can get him to say, oh, he just smelled guilty. And really, at that point, it comes down to our faith in the justice system, right? And I would like to believe that a jury would, if that was the basis of the evidence, would find for the defendant. Of course, that's not always true, but that goes back to the justice system as opposed to, mm-hmm. Whininess or, arbitrary stuff.
Just a couple last notes. I think one thing that I've tried to personally do in terms of the projects that I'm working on is make sure that there is at least a person taking in this information at the other end and then making a decision based on this information. So I think, my personal kind of creepy factor at some of these things comes from these situations where somebody is exposed to the basically raw outputs of the algorithm. So I think the Google search results are a good example of that. There's no kind of human intermediating that process. And I think that kind of speaks at least to having somebody accountable to a wide variety of factors, including what's coming out of this tool, essentially. I think the other thing that maybe hasn't been mentioned, and certainly could be possible down the line, but right now these problems are very hard to model. And so I think there's actually, as somebody who's kind of seen the output of this project, for example, we're still only giving 35% of our hits are actual conversions or misclassifications. So I think in that kind of context, as somebody who's getting a list of things where only 3 out of every 10 are right, I would still be pretty critical of what the algorithm is giving me and kind of use my good judgment on what's in front of me rather than just the raw outputs of the algorithm. So I think that's a distinction that I draw, at least. Yeah.
Okay, we're running out of time. I just want to see if anyone has any last thoughts before we close. No, okay. I was going to ask the international question, but we don't really have time. So I do think, however, a lot of the really core questions that you all put on the table for us are going to be very relevant tomorrow when we start talking more about some international context. So thank you very much, and we hope to see you back tomorrow.